What up, Kate Ruggs, the sober dog, and Gemma Girl, the other sober dog. Gemma, look. Coming at you from the park. Yeah. People, places, and things. When you get in sobriety, everyone's going to tell you, change your people, places, and things. What does that mean? What should you change? What shouldn't you change? We're going to get into it. So, early sobriety and sobriety in general, change your people, places, and things. I think 100% pretty much mandatory and necessary for early sobriety and sobriety in general. People, if I have friends, you know, that are still using or that aren't using but are just a bad influence, going nowhere, not about, you know, a change in their lives or family or anybody, that triggers me, that adds anxiety onto me, that stresses me out, I got to change that because I got to keep my mental health, you know, in check in sobriety, especially early sobriety. So any people that are going to jeopardize or question that, I can't be hanging around, you know, and there's ways to do it respectfully, especially if it's family, but you got to worry about you and you got to do you at this point in time. Places, you know, any old hangouts you were drinking or drugging at, any houses you were drinking or drugging at, you know, any, there's certain streets here in Rochester I don't even go down. There's just no reason for me to go down them because they're, you know, drug houses down there that I know of. And besides that, there's nothing there. It's not like, you know, the Walmart's on that street or anything. And even if it was, I'll go to a different one just to not see these places because sometimes they could trigger me. And there's just no reason to even get close to them because I'll drive down these streets, which aren't near me or my house. So driving down there, there's no positive that's going to come out of that except a trigger. If I'm trying to do it to just see if I'm strong enough, well, that doesn't make sense. And, you know, it's just going to lead to disaster. Maybe the first time I do it and I don't get high, but the thoughts are rewiring in my head, they're going again, and then I might try it again, and boom, I'm stopping in the house. Or I see somebody outside. Hey, man, come on in. Blah, blah, blah. And the last one, things, changing things. What things? There's a lot of, you know, for an example, I had a gym bag that I used to leave my house with every day, and I'd put gym clothes on top, and I'd be in my gym stuff, and I'd say, I'm going to the gym. And underneath that, those clothes were my needles and my water and my Q-tips and everything I needed to get high. When I got home from jail, from prison, that gym bag was still there. It was all cleaned out, but, you know, it's a beautiful, like, $70, $80 brand new gym bag. Not brand new, but, you know, nice. I threw it right in the garbage, you know, and I know that was a waste of money, but at the time it was, I don't want to see that bag. Just looking at the bag and the colors of that bag reminded me of what I used to hide in there. So there was just no reason to have it, and I got rid of it. And, you know, for financial reasons, you can't do this with everything, but you want to change things up. That's the whole point, you know, of all three of these, besides the obvious, you know, getting rid of the people that are bad influences. You want to rewire your brain. So, you know, I reorganized furniture just to have a different look because for, you know, for 5 years, I walked in the door and saw the furniture the same way, and every day I was getting high. So I just wanted a new look for a new me, changing things. You want to get your brain used to new things, a new way of life. I will put my socks on left to right if I used to do it right to left. I will take an extra exit and get off there on the highway and backtrack once in a while going to work just to get my brain out of that same rut routine, especially early sobriety if you're a couple days, weeks, couple months sober. To change your brain up so it starts getting these new, thinking in a new pattern, trying these new ways. Because living an entire sober life, or at least, you know, starting, is an entire new way of life that you got to get used to and get your brain ready. I could walk by the same house, you know, a dozen times. Nothing, don't even look at it, pay attention to it. But one day I'm having a bad day, I'm having a trigger, and I see that yellow house that I see every day, and it reminds me of an old dealer's house. Things like that will pop up, but you want to train your brain if you're driving by your drug houses just for the sake of driving by them, and then you see that yellow house and you're having a bad trigger one day, the two might, little things all mix together, and then you say, oh, screw it, I could do it just, you know, I could just go get high today. But by trying to get rid of the people, the places, things that are bad, as best you can, you're setting yourself up for a better chance of success. You know, everything is not going to be able to, you're not going to be able to get rid of every single possible thing. You're going to run into maybe a family member who, you know, maybe wasn't the best influence back in the day. These situations, you just want to build up your toolbox and your armor to be the best you can. So when you do see them, you know, you got a plan of attack, you got a plan of escape if you need to, you know what to say to get out of there. If you run into old people that are still getting high and they say, come on, come on. If you're looking for a good excuse to get rid of them, get them off your back, say, all right, I'm going to an AA meeting or I'm going to an NA meeting. You want to go? If they're not serious about sobriety or recovery, want to get sober, they will immediately run the opposite direction. And you know what? They might say, oh man, he's going to a meeting. Oh, good for you. Who cares? I don't want those people in my life anymore. So if they're not serious, that's fine. I will say whatever the hell I got to say to get them out of there. And I'm doing my thing. And if they're hating on it, I hope they, you know, eventually find, you know, their way before God, you know, God forbid they die. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is the competing. People say, you know, pretty much everybody, whether it's 12-step, outpatient, inpatient, whatever, counselors, addiction counselors, change people, places, and things. Everyone says that for sobriety and recovery. But then you have a lot of people, too, that'll say, but don't get in a relationship in the first year or don't change anything big in the first year, make any big decisions. So it's kind of contradictory. Well, you want me to change all the people, places, and things, but you don't want me to change anything big or make any big decisions. As far as that goes, basically, you don't want to add any undue stress you don't need. If you're moving out of state because it's the best decision for your sobriety, then yeah, go ahead. Now be prepared for the anxiety that's going to come with it. You know, you're going to be overwhelmed at some point, moving everything. But it's the best. Now, if you're moving out of state just to move out of state 2 months being sober, all that extra anxiety is just not worth it. Relationships, they say don't get in a relationship in the first year. Now, that's completely up to you what you're going to do. Maybe you're already in one and, you know, you're just getting sober. But the whole point of that is if I'm 2 months sober, I don't want to just go jump in a relationship because I'm bored or I'm lonely. And then there's going to be all these new feelings coming along with that, new responsibilities, new work. And then 2 months after that, she breaks up with me, and now I'm devastated. I'm 4 months sober, and I go out and get high. Or if she's in recovery too, and I broke up with her, she goes out and gets high. So it's not saying don't see people or don't if you meet somebody, but you don't have to force it or make these giant changes if they're unnecessary is kind of the reason. And not that dating is unnecessary, but take a couple months to try to focus on yourself. If Mr. or Mrs. Wright, you know, comes in your life the third week of sobriety, you know, enjoy the opportunity, but be prepared and keep building up, you know, your toolbox and your mental armor so that if something does happen 3 months down the road, 5 months down the road, you're prepared and you don't relapse if something like a breakup happens. So this is one of those things you got to kind of weigh the risks and the balances between change people, places, and things and don't change big things or make big decisions. You want to work on yourself, change anything negative, but don't change, you know, don't make giant changes for the sake of just making them. All right? Kate Ruggs, the Sober Dog out. Hey, hit that like, that subscribe. Trying to get more content out to everybody. Me and Gemma are out. See ya.